Hello and welcome back, as always, to our session on the Satanic Media Agenda, exposed today on this beautiful Sabbath day, July 18, 2020. Michael in Germany, welcome to the broadcast, the session on, I think, boy, I don't have a number for you. I wish I did, Michael, how many sessions we've done, but we're getting up there, aren't we?
Hi, Brett. Hi, dear listeners. I think we're in the early or mid-50s, something like that. Maybe the 52nd or 53rd or something like that. But these are just numbers. It's a second session, nevertheless, on Queen or Freddie Mercury, because I think that Freddie Mercury is by far the most interesting character in the group Queen. Yeah, and these are old-fashioned bands. And real band, so they can play an instrument, or at least they can sing. And because I know that Freddie Mercury is on position number 18 in the Billboard rank of the best singers of all time, so he can sing. And last time I was lacking some kind of English lyrics, and this time I hope that I can provide them, starting with My Fairy King, BBC session from 1973. Oh my, just about 50 years ago. Yeah, but you see, these are actually lyrics or texts and songs that Queen came up with. So yeah, what else to see? You see, this are no love songs, tender songs with about babies, from Babylon, or love, or animals, or praising Lord. No, 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 no. Like Queen said in Bohemian Rhapsody, no, 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 no. So what they are actually doing is promoting Antichrist agenda. Yeah? Why are they doing that? Well, you imagine why they are doing that. But it's about dragons fly like sparrows through the air, and baby lambs wear Samson there. So it must have to be something with Samson. Samson, oh, look it up in your Bible. Yeah, you know that Samson and Delilah thing? I haven't been prepared that much for this session now, I have to admit, but I think that Samson is a character who was very, very strong and was in love with a girl who was betraying her. I think her name is Delilah. Samson and Delilah ring a bell, Brett?
Yeah.
Yeah, something like that, huh? But you see, why is he mentioning dragons? Dragons, of course, Revelation 12 is in the name of Satan when he was fighting against the Lord Almighty and his angels, or the Archangel Michael and his angels, who fought for the side of the Almighty God. So you see that My Fairy King can see things. By the way, Brad, may I ask you, do you see this hand, this pointer here?
Yes.
Oh, that's good, because that's what I was intending to show. So you see here, My Fairy King can see things. He rules the air and turns the tides. Yeah, oh, he must be some kind of a god, huh? If he rules the air. Yeah, you imagine for yourself. To kill like knives, it's absolutely no positive content, yeah? But this is the song where in the last session, Brett was asking, Michael, please repeat, please help me out, what was the connection to Freddie Mercury? It's about the thing that he came up with the lyrics, that's the thing. And in this lyrics, you see here about Mother Mercury, Mercury, look what they've done to me. And this is about when he's speaking to Mother Mercury, look what they've done to me, but it's not been said who they are. You can maybe think about the fallen angels, but it's about the song which was originally being the source of the name Mercury. That's at least that Freddie Mercury tells you. But you see that, I wouldn't believe him, because if you go further along the lyrics for other tracks, then you will see that Freddie Mercury won't get to the truth. But just to show you, Brad, this is what Mother Mercury, or the name Mercury, comes from, okay?
Gotcha.
Okay. Fire burning in hell with the cry of screaming pain. Son of heaven, set me free and let me go. Does he have any experience with fire burning in hell? You see, this is just about take away power from the magic hand. You see, this is just about a fantasy text which has some reference to the Bible, speaking about Samson, speaking about the hell, maybe speaking about other books too, because the name Samson or the name hell are not exclusively being used in the Bible alone, but there are many, many, many things where they have also been copied to. Some of them could be, for example, I have to look at that up, but maybe Samson is also in Paradise Lost. Yeah, but this is all Gnostic teachings. This is all some kind of fairy tales. And I won't go into that thing. It's just about to tell you that Freddie Mercury is playing around with things here, which are, of course, not positive. So you see that he's trying to fool us that his origin of his so-called family name would be about his inspiration of this very song text here. Okay, let's move on. Seven Seas of Rhyme, Queen. I descend upon your earth from the skies. I command you very souls, you unbelievers, bring before me what is mine, the seven seas of Rhyme. I would have a guess. What is it about? Fear me, your lords and lady preachers. I descend upon your earth from the skies. If I remember well, Jesus Christ have been thrown into the world with the birth of Mary, or Mary giving birth for the baby child Jesus. Efficiently, I would have to avoid the name baby because I think that's quite an abbreviation of Babylon, but you see that the child, ye Jesus. But if he says here, I descend upon your earth from the skies, if it would be in the biblical context, it could only be or mean the comforter. But otherwise, it would be some kind of angels, and I would think that he's talking about his idol called Lucifer. Because, you see, this is not a positive context here. I will destroy any man who dares abuse my trust. Yeah, you see, this just to call Freddie Mercury, he is supposed to be on the outside a Zoroastrian, but I think that on the inside he's at least Luciferian.
At least, yeah.
At least. I challenge the mighty Titan and his troubadours. Yeah? Okay. This is an old picture of him in the 1980s in Munich with his girlfriend or hang around Barbara Valentin. It's funny that I try to pronounce it as American. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. Yeah, and he was also hanging around with his male friend. Yeah, yeah, you see, he's he knew both sides. Okay, there you go, it again. And this is just a repetition of last time. And I said that he worked on the solo album called Mr. Bad Guy. And we will go into that lyrics, or that especially in that English lyrics later on. And then he had a relationship to Jim Hutton and he went back to London. I said that in the last time. And his mate or lover, whatever, Jim Hutton, was HIV positive and died 2012 in his homeland, Ireland, and with lung cancer. Now, this is him as a wax figure at Madame Tussauds in London. Yeah. And all the things here are not really important. He died 1991, supposedly about from his HIV infection. 1986, his good friend Mary Austin knew from the Queen tour 1986 that this would be the last tour because of his illness. Freddie and Mary, they got 6 years, the usual physical relationship. One night he told her that he thinks that he's bisexual, but she replied, "No, Freddie, you are gay." I think that's a repetition of last time. Barbara Valentin, his German girlfriend, on the other hand, said he would have told her about his infection already in 1985. And according to David Wick, a close friend of Mercury, the singer knew it since 1984 of his HIV infections. But his last mate or friend, Jim Hutton, was being told 1987. And that's why I said that, I think that's very unfair that you don't inform your so-called lover or partner about some serious health issues. How did he die? Freddie Mercury died in his home on the 24th of November 1991 at the age of 45 from AIDS. That's the official thing. It's that AIDS is a very problematic thing because I think it's been proven about antibodies, and I don't want to get into a medical discussion. The official cause of death was, however, said to be a bronchial pneumonia, which was as a result of his damaged immune system by the so-called virus. You see that nobody knows exactly what it was. People think he died of HIV virus, but on the other hand, I wouldn't insist on that. Yeah, you see that having a damaged immune system can result of a lot of things, maybe about alcohol abuse or drug misuse and all the stuff. You know, having less sleep, being intoxicated with the unhealthy stuff, etc., etc. We don't know what it was. Officially, he died of AIDS. Yeah, that's the official thing. Mm-hmm. And I think we should leave it like that because we can not prove it otherwise. We are no medicine people. You're not a corona. We are not pathologists or whatever it's called in English. Yeah, we cannot examine that. And after all, medicine is a science which has been rewritten every 5 years. Yeah, so what is now the truth must not be automatically be the truth in 2025. So, skipping that. Some people think he's got extra teeth. Yeah, okay. Okay, that's the very friend here, David Wick, who claimed that he knew since 1984 that Freddie Mercury had this so-called HIV infection. Huh? Okay. On the 23rd November 1991, so a very interesting date, Mercury informed the publicity in a written note that he has been ill with AIDS. And the next morning, he got into a coma and he died in the evening in his house at the London town Kensington. That's where the Kensington Palace is, where the stepfather of Peter Gabriel was residing at the time, working at the time. At the age of 45, due to a lung inflammation or lung cancer, whatever. And he was being buried like in the Zoroastrian rite, according to the religion of his family. This is the Zoroastrian religion. But you see, there is no official explanation where he has been buried. Because some say that his ashes been thrown onto the Genfer Sea, which would be in Switzerland, to avoid having any location where people then could, help me out, Brad.
Go visit his grave?
So up to now, it is not clear where his grave is, actually. So this is kind of strange. Mm-hmm. On the 25th February 2013, the Daily Mirror, it's a well-known British newspaper, said they have discovered on the cemetery. It's a cemetery. All the graves are. Huh? It's a cemetery, I think. Mm-hmm. Kensett Green with the inscription in loving memory of Farouk Broussara, followed by the French text "Pour être toujours près de toi avec toi mon amour." Yeah. So to be near you with all my love would be the English explanation, and the initial M. The letter M is being seen as a hint to his girlfriend Mary Austin, whom Freddie Mercury, his home in Kensington, his money, and all the rights on his songs has given, according to his testament. But on 6 March 2013, it has been known that this inscription has been gone. And in November 2016, in his hometown, Feltham, there was another so-called inscription. Yeah, so it's really strange. But nevertheless, a quote from David Wick, the guy which you have seen before. Quote, "I often saw Freddie preparing to go on stage. Swigging down a few vodkas, he'd warm up his voice with a run of vocal exercises. His valet would have his stage clothes laid out for him. And one last puff on a cigarette, he would rush through his door to the stage to the cheers of Queen's adoring fans. He was like a hurricane. Quote, when I'm on stage, I become very different, he said. There are no half measures. You have to be resilient to be a rock star. You can't fail to once. And I know of another quote of Freddie Mercury, and he said, on stage, I am the devil. Moving on. This is a story which I came across. I don't know if it's true, but there has a book been written about it, or not only about that. Freddie Mercury helped Princess Diana dress man visit gay bar Kenny Everett. So to combine all the words now, the night Princess Diana dressed as a man to visit a gay bar with Freddie Mercury and DJ Everett. Princess Diana, the former wife of Prince Charles, went to the South London bar disguised as a male model. This episode, if it is true, is revealed in the new book by Kenny Everett's co-star Cleo Rocos. She described Diana as being in mischief mode on evening in question. Queen singer told the others they should let the girl have some fun. Yeah, this is Queen Diana. And there is a command or a verse in the Bible in the Deuteronomy 5. Deuteronomy 22, verse 5, that women shall not wear man's clothes and also not the other way around. Okay, so they watched The Golden Girls, supposedly, which is a television series. And after that, Princess Diana was being fixed with the idea that she could accompany Freddie Mercury at a gay bar. This is correct. Because these claims are in Miss Rocco's new book, The Power of Positive Drinking. Yeah, this is the location in question. Looks a bit Romish.
Yeah, it sure does, doesn't it?
Yeah, and I think that the Romans would be very fitting. I think that Red would like to read that.
Yes, Romans 1:24, wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanliness through the lusts of their own heart, or hearts rather, plural, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature, and likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust toward one another, in their lust one toward another, men with men working that which is unseemly and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet.
Yeah. So it doesn't matter if you're a girl wearing boys' clothes or are you a boy wearing girls' dresses, huh?
Mm-hmm.
And I think I was right, because in the meantime, where you have written spoken the Bible texts, I have looked up the Samson thing, and yeah, we got a hit. Because there's a book of the author of Paradise Lost, which is John Milton, and a book called Samson Agonistes. Yeah. This is a tragic closer drama by John Milton. It appeared with the publication of Milton Paradise Regarded in 1671. So maybe Freddie Mercury also was into Paradise Lost, so that he said that, well, Lucifer is a great guy. Okay, let's find out. Let's go further into the script with Freddie Mercury. As one of the most famous women in the world, speaking of Princess Diana, which had been killed in an accident, in a so-called accident in Paris, in a tunnel. It's a very strange situation. On the 13th column with the car, who was stolen before, and I think that the safety belts didn't work. So it's all the strange things coming down there on the... Yeah, so-called accident on Princess Diana, but that's another issue here. Princess Diana dressed up as a male model so she could enjoy an anonymous night out at a gay bar with Queen singer Freddie Mercury, television entertainer Kenny Everett, and his co-star Cleo Rocos. It has been claimed. So you see that maybe people are jumping on the train and saying, okay, I can make money with some fancy stories on deceased people. This is possible. I cannot prove that. Yeah, it's just about the thing that Freddie Mercury has been seen as gay. You see, also this book speaks about visiting a gay bar. You don't visit a gay bar if you are a heterosexual man. I needed to do so in my past once, because I had a customer who was running a discotheque. I didn't know it was a gay discotheque, so I was called up late at night with my colleague and we drove out there. Because they had an issue with an amplifier which was overheating. And we went up there and we were confronted with about 150 males. Some of them were topless, looking at us, smiling. And I think that was some of the things that where I was trying to suppress my smile with utmost intent. Yeah. It was a very funny situation because I think that my colleague and me were the only heterosexual guys in there. Okay, but nevertheless. Miss Rockers wrote in the book, I don't think anything could be more camp than Diana, Kenny, Freddie and me sitting on Kenny's sofa all watching the television series The Golden Girls. Kenny turned the sound on television and we improved the voices, but with a much naughtier storyline. Yes, you don't want to know that, I think. So it has been claimed they went into a gay bar. She tried on the outfit Kenny had intended to wear, a camouflage army jacket, hair tucked up into a leather cap and dark aviator sunglasses. It's a very strange story, to be frankly.
Yeah.
I think we could skip that because there are... Yeah, well, on the other hand, if you look at that picture, it's not so strange anymore, huh?
No.
Yeah, dancing and on the table with a bottle of vodka down his trousers. Oh, okay. Yeah. At least he could have shaved his legs. This is the author of the book. And this is the actual book. You can pick it up on Amazon. I wouldn't recommend, but... Nevertheless, you could do so. This is the lady in question, which is not anymore. And as far as my information is right, she has been buried together with the dogs. So she's not buried in the family belongings of the Windsors. Yeah. That could mean a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Because Diana died in a car crash in Paris in 1997, aged 36. Princess Diana was disguised as a male model. And it's been said that she was killed due to the fact that she was pregnant. But you see, there are so many things around Princess Diana which you cannot prove. It's about him. And this is about them. Because Freddie Mercury is related to the llama-loving Michael Jackson. But official story goes as far as Freddie Mercury canceled a duet with Michael Jackson in the 1980s because Michael Jackson insisted on bringing his llama to the studio. But there are other issues. Of course, we cannot prove that, but it's other issues here. Okay. In 1983, Mercury and Michael Jackson, hot off the release of Thriller, were plotting to record an album of duets. It was a perfect idea, the potential union of Queen and the nascent Queen of King of Pop. Three tracks had already been written and demoed, whatever that is, but the studios demoed. Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Ah, I see.
Okay. Demonstration. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. But the studio sessions ultimately faltered. Pardon me. Why? Because Jackson brought his llama or llama to the studio. What is it? Llama or llama?
Right, llama. That's fine.
Llama. Mercury was apparently not into it. But you see, that's not the basic storyline. The basic storyline is coming now. You know who Michael Jackson is, I think. Or was.
Yeah.
At least was. Was. Yeah, he was bad. Yeah. According to Mercury's former manager, Jim Beach, the rocker, speaking of Freddie Mercury, called him and asked, can you get over here? You've got to get me out. According to Mercury's former manager, Jim Beach, the rocker called him, meaning Jim Beach. So Freddie Mercury called his manager and asked, can you get over here? You've got to get me out of here. I'm recording with the llama. It goes on. However, Michael Jackson had his complaints too. The pop star wasn't fond of the singer's alleged cocaine habit, and they eventually had a falling out over Mercury's use of the drug in Jackson's living room. So, who's to blame? The one with the cocaine or the one with the llama? Okay, but there's another voice of Mr. Oh, sorry. Sir Elton John, because he's a CBE, of course. Mm. Yeah, commander of the British Empire. It's like James Bond. James Bond is also Commander Bond. Yeah, so Sir Elton John, Hercules John. He is at least bisexual too. So I think that Freddie and him made a great couple. And he was also being busy with other rock stars. And he has a problem with alcohol. In the Peter Gabriel reading, we have learned that he was having a good time on listening to Don't Give Up because that healed him, or helped him at least, with his alcohol abuse in the 1980s. That was Sir Elton John telling us in the sessions about Peter Gabriel, if I remember correctly. They claim that he has sold over 900 million tracks, records. I think that the real number is quite below that. I think that about 200 or 300 million, but nevertheless, he's highly successful. Yeah, but what about Elton John, besides fancy outfits and glasses? The singer's apparent drug use, speaking of Freddie Mercury, has since become part of his lore. Elton John, who's spoken candidly about his own drug use and addiction, once said this of the singer Freddie Mercury. Quote, Freddie Mercury could out-party me, which is saying something. We'd be up for nights, sitting there at 11 in the morning, still flying high. So, what do all these people have in common? Michael Jackson, Freddie Mercury, Elton John. They sell millions and millions of dollars, are the best paid so-called star singers in the industry. But they're all having their mental issues, problems, drug abuse, being some crazies insisting that some llamas had been in the studio for Michael Jackson. It had been known that he's got a chimpanzee, an ape. I don't recall his name now, but you see, you know that about that there are much pictures about Michael Jackson going around with his ape. So everybody has his fancy animal or his favorite animal, but yeah, Michael Jackson is on another level. Quote, because audiences love me, it's hard for them to believe that somebody like Freddie Mercury could be lonely. In fact, my kind of loneliness is the hardest. You can be in a crowd and still be the loneliest person because you don't really belong to anyone. Yeah, so he really was telling us he had almost no friends. I think the best friend he had was that Mary Austin. According to members of the medical profession, if Freddie could have survived one more year, the leaps in treatment for AIDS sufferers could have saved him. Yeah, could, would have, yeah. And I don't want to go into that because it's just, these are not facts, yeah. This is just things I would not go into. Quote of Freddie Mercury, I was extremely promiscuitive, but I have never stopped. Sex was a primary concern of my behavior. Yeah, this is according, I think now Romans will work again.
Yes, Romans 13:12. The night is far spent and the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not rioting and drunkenness, not chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying.
Yeah, what's been telling us when people about Elton John and Freddie Mercury telling us they have been up until 11 the next morning. So they exchange day with night. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and these are of course the works of darkness, because they are working and partying and doing and drinking all in the darkness. And in the day, where are you supposed to work hard, according to book of Genesis, not the band but the book, that you have to work hard for a living? Yeah, they just sing. And they're just having a good time, especially in the night. So I think that anyone who is really partying that much with drugs and alcohol are falling very easily as a victim for the dark side. But nevertheless, move on. Yeah, there are tribute concerts after his death 1 year. Freddie Mercury tribute concert for AIDS awareness. And there's also a posthumous album called Made in Heaven. Oh, I thought that God made the heaven. So if any human being claimed that this music was made in heaven, yeah, well, I have a hard time with that.
Yeah,
this is insulting. Huh? This is blasphemy. And of course, he's been depicted here with a big statue in several countries. This is on the Geneva Sea. It's in Switzerland. Yeah, this is the cover of Made in Heaven. So his right arm is stretching out to heaven. It's also the same gesture, or almost the same gesture, as the Baphomet of Eliphas Levi, Solve et Caligula. I'm not fit at the moment. The alchemy motto, and also as above, so below. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's been depicted here, or it's been written here, lover of Freddie Mercury, lover of life, singer of songs. Okay, now we can skip a little bit of German, because that I think that 99.9% of the general bread Norman Broadcasting Service audience are not into the German language. So, yeah.
It's, right.
Yeah, so we go into the real thing. We are going into that quite soon. Yeah. Oh, he's got also an asteroid, so a little not a planet, but something like that, called also Mercury, Freddie Mercury. Yeah, so you're really a star. And also a Boeing, and another Boeing of the Norwegian Air Shuttle has been named according to Freddie Mercury. Yeah. I'm sorry that I have not inserted the pictures here.
Don't worry about that.
Yeah.
No big
so
deal.
He's supposed to has the original birth name Farouk Bulsara. He's a Zoroastrian. Yeah. The prophet Zarathustra is the founder of Zoroastrian. He's a philosopher and theologian. He was an astrologer and alchemist. Oh, there we got this as above, so below again.
Mm.
Yeah. And the old teacher of wisdom, so-called wisdom. The name Zarathustra means a shiny being. Yeah, a shiny being. Great. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the four elements of air, water, earth, and fire are being seen as sacred. Hmm. There we go with Pink Floyd, Welcome to the Machine, where they have depicted on the front cover all the four elements, Brett, huh?
Yes.
Yeah. So it's the pure fire, which they see as holy. Yeah, it's the highest symbol of their religion is the fire. It's a fire in the temple. Yeah, and so this is the Zoroastrian. It is a well-known fact, this website speaks, that Freddie Mercury was raised by very religious Zoroastrian parents. The name Zarathustra means most beaming being, prince, prince of peace. The four elements, air, water, earth, and fire, are believed to be sacred. Yeah, good thoughts, good words, good deeds. Yeah, no one speaks about the creator god. They speak about the creation with the four elements. Yeah. But they don't speak about the creator god. So you can easily by that figure out what kind of religion Zoroastrian is. Yeah. And the astrologers and their magicians are called magi. This is where magic actually comes from. It comes from Zoroastrian. We will go into later into that. Yeah. And they have the so-called knowledge that the planets move around the sun, including the Earth, and the Earth are spheres. Yeah, and they renamed them Sun, Moon, Jupiter, Venus, Mars, Mercury, Saturn in Persian language. Hmm. I would like to see what Mercury means in Persian language, but I don't have any time to go into that. But this website has been here to promote Freddie Mercury, yeah? Because they say that, well, he's a great guy. Yeah, I have to skip that here. Yeah, he's a great guy. The actions of a Zoroastrian should be consistent with Ahura Mazda's laws. The actions should be virtuous, selfless, and should be offered to Ahura. Well, if you think that having a party, having a drink, drinking cocaine, singing loud, behaving yourself as a superstar has anything to do with the selfless, I think then you're on the wrong ship now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So he's really claiming that Freddie Mercury was a very religious and spiritual person. Yeah, but not Zoroastrian. Because if Zoroastrian means to be selfless, then Freddie Mercury cannot be a Zoroastrian because he was a superstar. He wanted to be a legend, remember? He doesn't want to be a star. He wanted to be a legend. He wanted to be remembered. And now he is being remembered. He got statues. He got millions of records, and he got even his own star called Freddie Mercury, high above. Yeah. So this is all the And they're claiming that he was attending a Navoyoti ritual, which is quite usual for Zoroastrians, as far as I know. And he was just 7 years old, as he was in a fire temple, and he was then in a ritual for his belief. Yeah, and they have a special belt, a holy belt, and a shirt. Yeah. And the shirt is white, yeah. And this has been called a kusti, yeah. So it was part of his stage clothing, holy belt, and the kusti shirt. Yeah. So this, they say, is a proof that he was a Zoroastrian because he was wearing a white shirt. Well, Brett, according to that, there must be millions of Zoroastrians in the United States.
And around the world. Yeah. That's just great.
Yeah. Finding humor where no humor is, huh? Yeah, this is about Freddie Mercury. You see, this is so-called a fan page, huh? Yeah. And he's also wear the sign of a flash. Yeah, it's about Zoroastrian has been told here. The flash, the lightning, is a special form of energy who does not need water or food or anything. It's about this is, well, I have another opinion about that. It would be Luke 10:18. Behold, I saw Satan fell like the lightning from heaven.
Mm-hmm.
But that's just me. I'm not a Zoroastrian. Yeah, and he was wearing this and wearing that. You see, if you see the color scheme, black and red, what does that tell you? It's about the Satanist color scheme. Mm-hmm. And this is a lightning. If it's two times or three times or whatever. Yeah. Selfless? Good deeds? Good works? Selfless? So Austrian? Sorry. Sorry. I don't fall for that. Absolutely. Don't fall for that. Yeah. Here you see the. I didn't know that the English text would follow initiation ritual. He joined a circle of Zoroastrian followers, and etc. 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 Sacred shirt. You see, it's all about materialism. It's all about, oh, there's something sacred. It's a tree, or it's a mountain, or a stone, or a shirt, or whatever. Yeah, something is sacred. Ah, yeah. So this is not a spiritual belief. This is a material belief. Yeah. So later on, it's been said here in German, Freddie Mercury would be a guy seeking for revenge, a drug abusing, hysterical guy with a very strange lifestyle, an eccentric guy who was making a fuss. And this is wrong, the website tells us. And I said, well, really? He was the loving family father who was often at home caring for his beloved wife and his beloved kids and didn't want to be on the stage in the light. He didn't have, well, the simple truth is he didn't have a family. He didn't have a real working relationship. He was just out night timing, partying, clubbing, etc. Yeah, so of course he was a drug abuser, of course he was into nightlife, of course he was bisexual. He was not only bisexual, but he was having fun, and that has nothing to do with selfless. I'm not judging the person here, the guy, Freddie Mercury. I'm just putting out the truth that he's at least the guy where I would say that he was selfless. But moving on. Yeah. Yeah, because this website really, really claims that he has no problems with drugs whatsoever. He didn't take any drugs and he was not an alcohol abuser. Well, maybe he should have talked to Elton John, yeah? And this goes for all Queen members, because one waitress in a restaurant in Montreal backs that. That's the claim, yeah? One waitress in a restaurant in Montreux in Switzerland has said, oh, no, 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 he didn't take any drugs. Okay, and that's the truth. Yeah. So don't believe Elton John. Don't believe Michael Jackson. Don't believe numerous other guys. Don't believe Barbara Valentin. Don't believe all these people. Please believe the waitress in the restaurant in Montreux. Okay, let's move on to the real interesting things. Because you see, all the things are coming also being related to the Zoroastrian expert, Professor Michael Stausberg, who was saying, oh, Zoroastrians are so humorous people, who are very falling for fun. Yeah, fun is real. And apart from the, because of this moral instance, Freddie Mercury has never taken any drugs. Yeah, alcohol, okay, he did as usual, but he was not an alcohol abuser and he just smoked. Yeah, oh, great that Mr. Professor Michael Stausberg has profound knowledge of Freddie Mercury. I would really more believe Elton John and all the other guys who have lived with Mr. Freddie Mercury. And I mentioned that he did a solo album because, skipped it here. The birthday feast is a very profound feast for Zoroastrian, very interesting. And also marriage. Okay. So Freddie Mercury's character. Yeah, good thoughts. Yeah, he was and remained Zoroastrian. Yes, the image of him is false. Oh, really? Yeah. He did not have a drug problem. I'm a little bit angry now because I didn't know that it was coming in English. He neither used illegal substances nor he was an alcoholic. This was also the case with all members of Queen, as one restaurant employee confirmed. That's really a fun side here, huh? That's really a fun side, huh? Oh my. Oh my.
Yeah.
Freddie Mercury would not have been able to perform on stage the way he did if he would take drugs or have an alcohol addiction. I can tell you from first-hand experiences, I did a lot of stars. Prepare the sound for a lot of stuff. And I once had, for example, the Weather Girls. It's Raining Men. And you cannot tell the number of the catering service or the pages of the catering service what they are wanted on the stage. Yeah, what kind of meal, what kind of drinks. And I had another German act, which was highly successful here, having several number one hits. And we had him as a premiere for the opening of a discotheque in 1994. And 1,000 people were staying in front of the stage. And then the manager came in a rush to me and said, Michael, can you imagine? I don't know if he's been able to perform because I just witnessed that he drank 2 bottles of vodka before he went to the stage. Yeah, so it's all really BS to avoid any rude name here. It is BS. I know from the manager of a discotheque, for example, that a well-known German act coming out of the techno music was drinking alcohol before the event. Before he performed on stage. So don't tell me that he would not be able to perform if he would have drank
some alcohol. Say, Michael, can I ask a question?
Please.
Who would write this kind of thing about Freddie Mercury? Fans, I guess, huh?
Yes, people who are defending Freddie Mercury or are Zoroastrians. Because, of course, he's a publicity figure making promotion for being a Zoroastrian, because I think that he must be one of the most famous Zoroastrian believers around the world. I think that's a connection here.
Yeah, that could be. And also, it's just the fact that, you can see how a man's religion has to dovetails into what they want to hear and what they want to see and what they want to talk about. And it's no wonder to me, Michael, that the real truth behind the scriptures, the sacrifice Jesus made to free us from sin, it's no wonder the world is in such turmoil today, is because there's hardly any teaching about the truth now, is there?
Yeah, of course. But you see, this is just to mislead the general audience into believing that Freddie Mercury was a great guy.
Of course, yeah, that's right. They want to worship him as a whatever. I mean, you know.
You see, there's an industry behind that, because you should worship him, and you should, of course, you should not, but according to the industry, the people are making the profit out of it. You should worship him. You should buy the records for Lucifer's sake, or for Satan's sake. Huh? You should buy the records.
Right.
So if anyone tells you, oh, you got a record of a drug abuser who was doing this and that, and you say, okay, I'm sorry for that, but now Freddie Mercury, oh, there are so many fans out there, and maybe we get a so-called shitstorm if we do things about Freddie Mercury, but I think we can take it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you see, Freddie Mercury wrote two songs that could be associated with drugs. For one, a crazy thing called Love Mansion Tracks, which could be misunderstood as it sounds similar to drugs. The other song is Mr. Bad Guy. Remember that he did a solo album of the same name, in which he sings about ecstasy. However, this word is not a reference to the illegal substance, but simply to the emotion. Oh, Brad, would you like to go into this lyrics?
Sure.
Mr. Bad Guy, what about Zoroastrians must make good works, good deeds, good thoughts? Mr. Bad Guy, is that good works, good deeds, good thoughts? Or what is?
Oh boy.
Mr. Bad Guy is about the astrological, the mercurial. Oh, Freddie Mercury does not want to be viewed as Mr. Bad Guy, as some kind of freak. He shares how misunderstood he feels and challenges listeners to follow him into the etheric world as the ideational Zoroastrian motto, good thoughts, good words, good deeds, suggests. Ethical values were very important to him, as the lesser known Freddie Mercury song Money Can't Buy Happiness demonstrates. And I said, well, then let's go into the lyrics of Mr. Bad Guy.
Wait a second, Michael, what kind of word is that? Ideal. I'm sorry.
I wanted to ask you the same question.
This is okay. I would use the word ideology here, but that's just me. Ideational. I've never even heard
that's ideational. In German, it's EDL. So it's.
I'm gonna look that up while you're talking here.
Maybe
a word. I've never seen that before. Ideational.
Yeah. Okay, I'll go into the song's lyrics.
It is a word. It says relating to the formation of ideas or concepts.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, let's go into the song text. Let's go chasing rainbows in the sky. It's my invitation. Let's all take a trip on my ecstasy. I'm Mr. Bad Guy. What would you think what ecstasy is here? I would say that it's a illegal drug, on my ecstasy. No, but it's been main as some kind of thought and emotional. Okay, let's go further. I'm Mr. Bad Guy. Everybody's Mr. Bad Guy. Can't you see I'm Mr. Mercury? Yeah. So actually, it's a combination of Mr. Mercury is Mr. Bad Guy. So he's admitting he's Mr. Bad Guy, at least in the views of the general public. But it goes further. Spread your wings and fly away with me. Oh, who's he when he's asking someone out to spread his wings and fly away? Because actually, I don't know any man or woman on that behalf who has wings. But
Oh, wait. Doesn't Mercury do? Mercury does.
Yeah, Mercury does.
Mother Mercury?
Yes, Mercury does. Yeah. Spread your wings and fly away with me, because he's Mr. Mercury. Huh? He's the Mercury is, of course, the Angelos between heaven and earth.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And what did we learn? It's about made in heaven, huh? Made in heaven, yes. Uh-huh. So, bad communication. I feel like the president of the United States of America. I'm Mr. Bad Guy. Well, yeah, I'm everybody's Mr. Bad Guy. Can't you see I'm Mr. Mercury? I'm Mr. Bad Guy. They're all afraid of me. I can ruin people's lives. What about here? Good deeds, good thoughts, good works? What is that kind
of? I can ruin people's lives. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So what is here positive? What is here in a way that Zoroastrians would fall for and said that, well, this is a great song of our beloved Zoroastrian role model? I don't see anything.
How pathetic.
Yeah, so please, you can defend your Freddie Mercury because he's got a talent to sing. Okay, I admit that. But please go into his lyrics, and this is just one of the first lyrics here where we are going to examine here. It's nothing about positive, nothing about helping others. It's the opposite. He can ruin people's lives. And he did. For example, if we follow the original story of his former friend, that his former friend wasn't aware that Freddie Mercury was suffering from HIV. And then, of course, can he ruin people's lives? If this illness can move from one people to another, from one man to another, yeah, then love would tell you that you have to tell your loved ones before you get in touch with them. Yeah? But he just said that I can ruin people's lives. Because he's Mr. Bad Guy. Oh, but he's seen in a totally wrong way. This is all BS. This is really BS, Brad. And I like to move on. I think this is so obvious here. How obvious should that be? Yeah, he's not misunderstood. Yeah, share his money with others. Yeah, and all the stars. Yeah, he followed a daily yoga regimen. Oh, great, yes. Yoga is also religious praising of the elements or of the planets. You bow down in front of the sun or in front of the moon. Good friend of mine comes from Persia and actually is holding yoga lessons, and he told me some things about that. So it's just not internet knowledge here. It's just that I talk to people. Yeah. Mitra, the Zoroastrian goddess of contracts. Mitra? Oh, there was an interesting ancient religion in Rome before they fell for Roman Catholicism called the Mitra cult. Yeah. So it was also in Rome. And I think we should skip that really because in German it's called with Jörg the hour of the truth, and you see that there's so many things about Freddie Mercury that he'd been misunderstood and treated wrong. Yeah, and I think we have found out that he's not. Yeah, because you see that what's that. This is selfless. This is good works, good deeds, good thoughts. I'd say this is a Babylonian worshipping with candles and holding out your hand and being enlightened from behind to be some kind of a superstar or an angel or a messenger from the gods. And also, he's been pictured or photographed from below. So this pose means I am superior. I have to be praised, because I am not a mere human. I am not a mere star. I am not a mere superstar. I am legend. I have no other words for that pose, actually. Maybe Brett has something.
Well, right. I mean, it's definitely quite... Was this from a concert, or is this...
I don't recall. It's from last year.
No, okay, this
I think it's from some kind of tour or some kind of... I think it's Who Wants to Be...
It's on a stage then, right?
Who Wants to Live Forever or something like that. I really have to look it up. But you see that the candles even are being displayed in that case that it corresponds to his hands, or his hands corresponds to the candles. You see that everything is around him, the candles. So it's just like in a church. But he's the one who has been enlightened, yeah, illuminated.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so he is the big figure. He is the big guy. Yeah, he can ruin people's lives. Hmm? Yeah, don't fall for false idols. It doesn't matter if it's called the Bee Gees or the Queen or whoever. Simple Minds. Simple Minds got a very, very ugly track, yeah,
mm-hmm.
But they call sanctify yourself, be a part of me. Yeah,
right.
Whoa. Yeah, everybody is God, huh? Luciferian doctrine. Yeah, Simple Minds are a part of the Luciferian doctrine. Yeah,
yeah.
You see, this is the answer for your question. So elegant, Freddie Mercury shows up in the video to the song "Who Wants to Live Forever," which was supposed to be movie music about the Highlander. Yeah? The Highlander, there can only be one. And this is his asteroid. You see it here? This is Freddie Mercury. Maybe this is Michael Jackson, someone, because he was selling more records. And this would be, I don't know, Elvis Presley. No. It's ridiculous. What? It's so ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
right.
It's really ridiculous. Yeah. The naming of the asteroid Freddie Mercury. Oh, this is so important for some people. Yeah. The legendary rock group. Yeah. Great. And.
There it is. Man.
There it is. Coming down from the sky now, huh?
Norwegians got nothing better to do than to celebrate Freddie Mercury on their airplane, huh?
Yeah, and you see that when he is descending, when the plane is descending to the airport, coming down of the sky, then Freddie Mercury also comes down from the sky. And you see here, Freddie Mercury is imprinted here, yeah.
Oh boy.
So I said then, I make the remark then, oh, you see, there flies the phoenix.
right.
Yeah. This is from the band.
Oh yeah, the phoenix, of course.
From last session, yeah. Yeah. Who wants to live forever?
Yeah.
Freddie Mercury said, yeah, who wants to live forever? I will have fun. Yeah. And you see, any resemblance? Don't tell me that he was not aware of that statue here. I don't fall for any statue. This is not Christian. This is Roman Catholic. It's in Brazil. Yeah, it's the statue of Jesus in Rio de Janeiro, in Brazil, in South America, or maybe better be known as Latin America. Latin, because the Roman Catholic Church came with their conquerors and they slayed the people. Or unless they would be converted to Roman Catholicism. Yeah? Compare the poses. Okay, let's move on. And it is forbidden to erect any statues in the Bible, erect any pillars. And it's also forbidden in the real second commandment for real Bible-believing Christians to make any image of something in heaven, on the earth, or below the earth. And Jesus Christ, as far as I, or as far as we know, is in heaven. But most of these people do not read the Bible. Because if they would read the Bible, these people who are being displayed here on this photograph would not be present here. Because they don't would not care for any statue, for any wrong thing in stone. Yeah. And this is our Zoroastrian Freddie Mercury, who is absolutely selfless.
Isn't that something, Michael, in the lyrics for Who Wants to Live Forever? I'm reading through them right now.
Yeah.
It goes through all the stuff about, oh, you know, forever. Who wants to live forever? There's no chance for us. It's all decided. This world has only one sweet moment set aside for us. Who wants to live forever? Who wants to live forever? Who dares to love forever? Oh, when love must die? Mm-hmm. But touch my tears with your lips. Touch my world with your fingertips. We can have forever. We can love forever. Forever is our today. Who wants to live forever? Forever is our today. Who wants forever anyway? The last line, who wants or who waits forever anyway? Who waits forever? No, we want it today. See, it's all about today. It's all about self. Mm-hmm. So people trying to defend him, it's pointless. You read the lyrics, it says it all.
Yeah. Of course, you see, he gets away with that by saying, oh, it's just movie music. It's about the movie, the film of the one Highlander.
Oh, sure. That's right. But, oh, yeah, yeah. Just an act.
Yeah, it's just an act. But he's responsible for everything that he's been saying. At least that's my understanding. You see, even if he would not go into the lyrics, we could also go into the pictures.
Michael, well, this is the very problem with our so-called entertainment. It's all of these ideological ways of thinking that get promoted to do these grandiose productions to promote a movie or whatever. But, you know, when it comes down at the end of the day, who's going to be responsible for what's said? Is Freddie Mercury responsible for what he wrote and what he said? Well, duh, yeah, he is. And you're telling me he's not? Mm-hmm. It's just so incredible how the world works on this presumption of, I try and think of the name of this thing they give, this term they give this stuff, to have, what do they call it again? You know, no one's taking responsibility, essentially, is what's going on. It's just like, you know, why don't we talk about these things? Why don't we?
It's the whole of the law.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Yes.
We could also go into symbolism, Brett. You see that analyzing this picture would reveal a lot.
Yeah. So man, look at that chair.
Look at that chair. It's a chair of a king.
Yeah.
Or of nobility.
The emperor has no clothes, eh?
Yeah. At least. Less
clothes. Almost no clothes.
Yeah, almost no clothes. Yeah,
mm-hmm. Very close.
So he's what's he doing there? He's enjoying life with his left hand. So eating an apple, relaxing. He has nothing to do, and he's in control.
And he's wearing sunglasses.
And he's wearing black sunglasses. He's in control because he's got a remote control in his right hand. And he's wearing sunglasses and black sunglasses inside. Who would wear black sunglasses inside? I can tell you, at least from my experience, only someone who does not want to show his real identity.
True.
want to hide behind dark
someone under subject. The influence of some kind of substance or,
for example, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's true. I mean, you see people around with sunglasses from time to time, and you know, you just can't help but wonder what are they trying to hide?
But not inside. And you see here, sun is coming from the side, and he's not. It's not the extreme exposed to the sunlight here. Yeah. So it's not absolutely necessary to have dark tinted sunglasses unless. You got
maybe he was outside and he just walked in and he's sitting down quick.
Oh, yes. And that's why someone by accident came nearby and said, "Oh, man, Mr. Mercury, can I have a photograph with you?"
Right.
Yes. It's all by accident. Of course, this image depicts actually a role model for Zoroastrian because he's totally selfless in this picture, has doing great deeds for the apple industry. Oh, well. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's move on. Yeah.
Ugh.
Totally selfless, huh? Totally selfless. It's not about him, actually. It's about his clothes, huh? he wanted to be a legend. Yeah, he wanted to be remembered. He did anything about fancy outfits, behavior. Yeah, something like that. Yeah. Would you really expose yourself that way for a photograph? You see, if somebody tells, I would not remembered or recognize Freddie Mercury in the first place if it was not been displayed in the Google search that this photo actually depicts Freddie Mercury. I would suggest that this was an invitation for having sex with someone in bed. Maybe also someone with leather trousers, maybe something bi or gay or whatever, but this is could be an advertisement in a sex magazine. You would not want to be photographed like that, and your fiancé or your best friend, or you wanted to be in some kind of newspaper with your open trousers. Yeah, don't get me that this picture has been taken by accident. He's smiling. He's not hiding anything. Yeah, he's inviting you. Yeah, come over. Yeah. So I think that the chapter of Romans is quite fitting to Freddie Mercury. Yeah, and what's that? I think I have to make it a little bit more. Yeah. What's that? Is properly dressed or what? You see, he's displaying his chest. He has very, very narrow trousers or whatever here. Yeah, and this is also a suit. I don't know if it really being fitting for a male person. And we're talking about the 70s and 80s here. We're talking not about 2020. That's about 50 years ago. Imagine what kind of impact Freddie Mercury made when he was making men's dresses. Yeah, he was a tailor or something, a designer of men's wardrobe, we learned in last session. Yeah. If that is his idea of being a male wardrobe, I don't want to see his idea of a girl wardrobe anyway. Oh, okay, so then move on. Has no shoes also. Yeah, well. And here, what is he doing here? Yeah, you see that he goes on his knees before a man. Praising him for his excellent guitar play award. These are rituals. This is not a usual behavior for a singer. Yeah, but Queen is on another level, huh? Oh yeah, Queen is on another level. Yeah. It was so hot this day that he put his shirt off, huh? Yeah, And also, he's got this long microphone stand without the feet. Ah, what could that be a symbol for, huh? It's up to your imagination. Don't want to get rude on Brad Norman's channel. Yeah, it's just some pictures of, speaking of the microphone stand, huh?
Yeah.
Sorry, Brad, but this, for me, is totally obvious.
Yeah, totally obvious.
Yeah?
You know, this is starting to remind me of Kiss all of a sudden.
Yeah.
Except, you know, in Kiss, the lead singer went the other way. He didn't go for the males. He went for the females. Remember?
Yeah, went for the so-called chicks.
Gene Simmons, that's it.
Yeah, that's him, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you see that, if you see these pictures, you know his works. You know his fruits. On their fruits, you will know them. And you know his fruits. He's been illuminated here, big time. He's been on a stage. He's been elevated. And what's he doing here? Oh, he's holding his stick. His microphone. No?
Like a little kid with a stick.
Yeah.
I say that intentionally, you know, because kid is a reference to a child goat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm.
Or a baby goat.
Yeah, and he's been also famous for being topless most of the time.
Yeah, yeah, right.
With the,
body odor?
With the sign of onion.
Get away.
Get away. Okay, that better? Any better?
Oh, man.
Yeah, it's like a kind of preacher here, huh?
Oh, yeah, he's got to be putting on an act, doesn't he?
Or his wings, being Mercury, being the messenger of the gods, huh? That what actually every singer is a messenger of gods, but the false god. Huh? You see, this is a stairway, huh? To heaven or what? Yeah, these are rituals. It's not about the song, it's about the ritual. It's about the symbolism, it's about worshipping Lucifer. That's what it's all about. To perform a song, you don't want to. You don't
see.
Need...
Come join me. We can have our forever today. See, they want their forever today.
Yeah, at least your audience gets some fancy pictures today, huh?
And who waits forever anyway? You know.
Yeah.
You gotta be kidding me.
No, I'm not kidding. This is part of a serious act.
And people, can you say Medusa?
People get paid. People paid him to do so.
Instead of serpents, he's got bananas.
Yeah, in German we got a phrase talking totally banana, which means you're totally on the wrong track or totally.
Yeah.
Banana. Yeah.
I think he had a little too much vodka, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, but nevertheless, he's been a legend. In gold.
Oh, gold even, huh?
Or bronze or whatever.
Right. Yeah.
Well, he's an idol.
Sure.
So this one you know already. And what do people do? Oh, see, they're making hearts and candles and flowers and pictures. Yeah, so they are worshipping him. It's a worship.
Oh, yeah.
He's been larger than life. Yeah, you see that, okay, this is here a perspective problem, but I think that the statue is about, I don't know,
sure.
I think 10 feet or something.
No? Yeah, that looks right.
9 to 10 feet.
You can see the man behind him.
He's far away.
Maybe
but you see that
15 feet behind, though.
Yeah.
Not that far away.
At least larger than life. Every statue which is larger than life is also can be seen as having some kind of meaning that he's been more important than a usual human.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got here a coat and it looks like a wing here, but that's not the big part. Interesting here, the chimneys or the roofs. Yeah, but Switzerland anyway is the land of the knights, of the Knight Templars.
Michael, I'll tell you, as being a Bible believer myself, I would shriek in horror if someone made a metal man image of me.
Yeah.
I'm dead and gone.
Daniel, Book of Daniel. Huh? Yeah.
Wouldn't you, Michael?
Yeah, of course. I don't want to be.
Ugh. Why would anyone want to do something like that? But, oh, I want to be a legend. Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, there's plenty of heathen around to feed your desires, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the first commandment, God said, you should not have any other gods, and you should make no image about something which is in heaven, and or in the earth, or below. And
right.
Yeah. And so in this here, I Still Love You, it's about the Bohemian Rhapsody here. You see that having some kind of fingernail here and hair, which looks more like a girl or like a woman. Yeah, you can imagine. Now, this is also a position, the X position is also the position of Lucifer rising or Osiris rising.
Yeah.
That's on another level. The Live Aid performance of Queen on the 13th of July 1985 in London Wembley Stadium is a legend. The stage show just took 20 minutes, but that was enough to steal the show from all the other artists. Even Elton John was deeply moved from this unbelievable show, which was typical Queen, and was storming into the backstage area where Mercury, May, Taylor, and Deacon could not rest for any words. And everybody who has joined this event will never forget it. Yeah, well. Yeah, and he's wearing here some kind of thing around his arm also, I noticed. And there are some symbolism, spiritual meanings of these items as well. Some kind of Egyptian bracelets, etc. It could also have some kind of meaning. Yeah, bracelets. Yeah, and I think that Mr. Brian May will be handled next time, huh? I think we are far more than 1 hour now.
I think so. I think so. So I don't know about everyone else in the listening audience of our YouTube channels here, Michael, but Queen, the whole band, all of that, it was just such a extravagant what would you say? I mean, the music is just so in your face and just really quite outrageous. I remember, first hearing Queen and just kind of not really getting into it, Michael. I don't know about you, Michael, but it's just not my taste at all. But nonetheless, he's definitely trying to promote some type of belief system, yes. And
Zoroastrian, yes.
Zoroastrian, yeah. So that definitely fits him pretty well. No doubt that's what he's doing. Or what he did, excuse me.
I always thought that the music, and especially the voice of Freddie Mercury, was very aggressive.
Yes, very aggressive.
And we will get into that quite soon. Maybe also in the next session, because there are some strange songs from them. You will not believe unless you see the lyrics and the deeper and some deeper meaning of it. But these guys are not by accident that successful. They are purely claiming Luciferian spirit. They are absolutely claiming that it does not matter unless you have fun.
Well, and the thing is, they do it in an esoteric way. It's not in your face. And well, no, they can easily, you know, through exotericism, they just deny, no. Oh, we're just doing this as an act. This is just to do, you know, our promotion. And this is an act. This isn't what we really believe. But that's just the exoteric. The esoteric is entirely different. Isn't it, Michael?
Yeah, of course. But you see, that's because many or most of the people are in the Antichrist spirit because they don't believe in Christ. These artists are so successful.
Or even worse, Michael, they might believe in Christ, but they're stuck in a doctrine of Antichrist, which is, you know, again, we got to work out our salvation through the scriptures with Christ alone, for his glory alone. And we have to get rid of the deeds of our own flesh. And that's the hardest part of all of it, is recognizing that we have all fallen short and have sinned. And, you know, it's just one of these things. You know, the dog always returns to its own vomit, right? So that's kind of how it is with the flesh too. It just has a tendency to just, you know, go right back to the vomit. And it's only the spirit that saves us, the spirit of Jesus Christ, that is specifically. And his propitiation, his sacrifice he gave one time for all mankind. And so very important, so very fundamental to our faith as Bible believers. But when we look at this troubled world, it's just becoming obvious how hard it is to convince someone that doesn't have the spirit in the faith of Jesus Christ to begin with.
Because they think that that's quite the usual way.
Yeah, that's right.
But you have to make it in the world. You have to be selfish. You have to be on your own. You have to use your elbows. You have to fight against each other. It's always against each other. So it's this football club against that football club, and this political party against that political party. Or it's about this band against that band, or this car maker against the next car maker, or BMW against Mercedes-Benz on this.
That's
against
right.
That.
That's it's, right, Michael.
It's always
You'll never,
against,
ever
always,
be able to convince them that.
It's always to spread anger and to spread division.
Sure. And you know, they're right. That's the thing. You got to, at some point, you just say, okay, you can have it. It's yours if you want that. That's going to be the way it's going to be for you, but I choose differently. And that's what I love about these sessions Michael and I are doing on this Satanic Media Agenda. We're just trying to show you, as Bible believers, how outrageous and how deep the esoteric teachings are through the lyrics, through the different quote-unquote acts. And they're really satanic acts. They're not biblically sound at all. And we don't recommend them or do we promote them at all here. We're just trying to just show you how deep it goes. It's very deep, and it's not that easy to come to this knowledge if you're not going to read your Bible. So again, Michael and I will hammer this through that we must refer to our scriptures to set us straight. We must read our Bibles. We must recognize this. And also we must remember our history that has fulfilled the prophecies of the Bible. And that's probably the real hard kicker for everyone, because no one wants to remember this history. They want to put it behind them. They fought these world wars in the 20th century to completely destroy Protestant faith. And in a lot of ways, they've succeeded, and especially bringing us this satanic media agenda. And Michael and I, we're going to expose it. We're going to keep continuing to expose this because, this is idolatry. It is taking something good that God created and turning it completely bad and turning it to the rebellion that the fallen angels have been actively pursuing in the hearts and minds of men. So that wraps it up for me, Michael.
Yeah, that's also a great closing comment of you. And I would recommend to read your Bible, also the chapter of the Romans, which would be very fitting for everything which is related to this topic here. And so on this thing, I would like to read to close it down. And thanks for listening. And read your Bible, Maranatha, from me. Goodbye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.